Newsbrief. Half-Life 2 and Portal Richard Iqdolapo has rejoined Valve. Nearly 2 years after leaving the studio, Iqdolapo departed the company in February 2017, after over a decade at the studio, during which time he worked on a menagerie of popular titles, including Half-Life 2, Episode 1, Episode 2, Portal, and both Left 4 Dead games. His return was initially spotted by Reddit user Trenchman, who spied Iqdolapo's name in the credits for Valve's latest release Artifact. Trenchman then reached out to Valve boss David Uhl, who replied to confirm the news, with Valve's network confirming the legitimacy of the email. It's unclear what convinced Iqdolapo to return, although it probably has something to do with Half-Life 3. Niantic announced its Beyond Reality developer contest earlier today, and is encouraging our devs to enter and create a game using the studio's real-world platform for a chance at a prize pool of more than $1 million. This could be a good opportunity for developers interested in using a new tool to create our projects, and the chance at earning a stipend and showing their work at a demo day hosted by Niantic. As explained in a blog post, the studio is seeking a team composition of at least 5 developers, with experience in Unity and Java server development. In terms of product, the possibilities are endless. Our definition of games is pretty expansive, so if you have an idea that bridges gaming and other areas like physical activity, social, travel or shopping, please feel free to submit. The post reads, a select group of 10 teams will earn a stipend and access to the Niantic Real World platform, and finalists will work for a 3-month period, with the goal of showing off their work at a demo day in San Francisco. In addition to regular guidance and discussion from the Niantic engineering team, finalists will be brought to the San Francisco Bay Area to meet with executives and lay the groundwork for the work to come. Interested developers are encouraged to apply through Niantic's contest site and field any further questions to email protected. Netflix has confirmed rumors from earlier this week and officially announced that it is hiring Spencer Neumann as its new chief financial officer, just days after he was placed on leave pending firing from that same role at Activision Blizzard. Activision Blizzard announced in a securities filing this week that it was letting Neumann go for reasons unrelated to the company's financial reporting, a disclosure controls and procedures, though the specific reasons for the firing were not detailed at the time. Since then, Activision Blizzard has said in a press release that Neumann was terminated for cause for violating his legal obligations to the company, a violation that in all likelihood looks to be related to his quick jump over to Netflix. That same day, rumors circulated that Neumann was on track to be hired by Netflix as the company's key fool, and according to MarketWatch, the company has since confirmed those early whispers. Neumann joined up with Activision Blizzard in May 2017, after leaving his position at the Walt Disney Company, and is now set to start as Netflix's financial chief early on this year, replacing David Wells, Netflix's key foe since 2010. Following Neumann's departure from Activision Blizzard, CEO Dennis Durkin temporarily assumed the responsibilities of key foe, though Activision Blizzard now says that Durkin will once again become the company's key foe, now that it's evident that Neumann has left the position for good. The FBI announced earlier today that it took action against the 15 domains that reportedly helped take down other people's websites, game servers and other online services through distributed denial of service DDoS attacks. This is pretty notable, as the holiday season tends to be plagued by DDoS attacks, at least according to the FBI. Successful DDoS attacks have been known to take down game servers, like Blizzard's Battle.net in the past, so devs should be mindful of that in the future. As reported by Kotaku, the FBI seized 15 Twitter websites that allow anybody with Bitcoin or a credit card in exchange for overwhelming a server with requests, domains yesterday, including criticalboot.com, rigibooter.com, downtham.org, and quantumstress.net. Because booters provide less powerful DDoS attacks in exchange for little money, they have gone largely unnoticed since they tend to be marketed as stress testers, designed to help people test servers' capacities for withstanding such attacks. According to the FBI, these services are easy to find and are a low barrier to entry for users looking to engage in cybercriminal activity. These services offered easy access to attack infrastructure, payment options that included Bitcoin, and were relatively low cost. Read the press release issued by the FBI. Each of the services was tested by the FBI, which verified those DDoS attack services offered through each of the seized websites. While testing the various services, the FBI determined that these types of services can and have caused disruptions of networks at all levels. The United States government's Federal Commission on School Safety has released the final copy of a report on school safety. The report was commissioned to research and recommend solutions to advance the safety of schools in the United States, following a mass shooting at the Marjorie Stoneman Douglas High School earlier this year. The report itself is broken down into three sections: prevent, protect and mitigate, and respond and recover, each of which contains several more focused chapters on individual issues and topics. The entire report can be found here. Video games, along with movies, music, television, social media, books, and graphic novels, are covered in Chapter 7 of the section on prevention under violent entertainment and rating systems. According to one study cited in the report, roughly 68% of video games depict violence in some way. This is compared to, from the same study, 90% of movies, 60% of TV shows, and 15% of music videos. Children have 24/7 access to multiple forms of entertainment at their fingertips. Reads the chapter's opening paragraph. Their exposure to violent entertainment is of particular concern in television, video games, social media, music, movies, graphic novels, and books. Violent content is ubiquitous across these platforms and continues to grow. The report cites a variety of studies on both sides of the video game violence conversation and digs into the efficiency of rating systems, like the ASAP, a system that the report says has gained high levels of trust among parents. According to a 2016 analysis of the ASAP, 86% of parents are aware of the rating system, while 73% say that they check a game's ASAP rating before purchasing a game for their kids. Still, at the close of the chapter, the Federal Commission on School Safety recommends that all of the self-regulators should review and improve policies to ensure access to content is limited to age-appropriate consumers, while also recommending that educational agencies and school leadership should focus on strengthening internet safety measures at schools. 11-Bit Studios has raised $500,000 for War Child United Kingdom by creating charity DLC for this War of Mine. In the 4 years since the game launched, the studio pledged to donate 100% of the cash from its charity DLC to a British organization. which is dedicated to helping children affected by conflict all around the world. Since then, over $500,000 has been donated to the cause, helping our child deliver aid throughout countries including Afghanistan, Iraq, the Central African Republic, Democratic Republic of Congo and Yemen. The cash has allowed for the creation of 3 temporary learning spaces, allowing 260 children to carry on with their education and complete their school year, while also providing summer schooling to 475 students in Iraq.